Greetings, I'm Solidus-Skully and welcome back to Enter the Matrix. I hope you enjoyed driving sections and lots of cutscenes because, well... yeah, this is basically it. And we also treated to another Cell Dweller track, Symbiont, which you might possibly remember as the closing theme to Skully Reviews back in, 2018 before I kinda switched it up for a shorter one because, goddamn, the runtime that was getting really fucking long. Anyway, we're escaping from the, albino twins. Yeah. And, well, this is part of the reason why I prefer to play as Niobe in this segment, because, again, the driving AI is not very good, to put it lightly, but at the same time, like, I don't know, they're very persistent, and the fact that you also have to use your focus meter as Ghost, you know, to keep them away from you, it's just a bit of a pain in the ass, and what makes it a little bit worse is really depending on the amount of traffic in the road, because... let me tell you, like, the amount of times you get stuck behind cars and you can't escape quick enough because the twins have very, very persistent AI is frustrating. I don't know. I mean, I do like the music, though. Like, Symbiont is one of my favorite Soul Dweller tracks, but... eh. I mean, it's a decent segment, it's just one that can get very frustrating after a while. So, I mean, I guess exercise caution or, I guess, play on easy difficulty, but I don't know. Alright, on normal and above, it's... angry. I don't know, like... I mean, I will say that, like, compared to the other driving level, at least it doesn't have that whole toll booth kind of thing. So you don't need to waste time waiting for an exit to open up so you can escape, which... I guess can make it fine, I just kind of wish the, you know, enemy AI for the twins was a little bit more fine-tuned. Or you could kind of, like, set up little traps for them that, you know, could hold them back while you made your escape. I don't know, I guess possible future game mechanics to better think up in a future game, I guess. Well, I mean, not that I really can, because I don't think Shiny Entertainment's a thing anymore, because... if I remember right, I believe, it was them and a developer called The Collective became Double Helix Games, which, as I'm sure you well know, went on to make such fantastic video games as Silent Hill Homecoming. What a truly wonderful, fantabulous thing that is to make those terrible games.
Operator.
Is the exit clean?
As vestal as my bunghole.
I'll see you soon.
Captain.
After you.
This is Zion Control to the Logos. Bay 3 is standing down. Your path is cleared to Bay 2. Welcome home.
Thank you, Control. It's good to be home.
Damn good.
Look at that. Almost a full house.
No Neb.
If I was Morpheus, I wouldn't be in a hurry to get back here.
What do you think the commander will do?
I don't know, but I'm staying as far away from that as I can.
Hello, me again. I know I'm talking over a cutscene, but... well, there's a lot of them, and... again, I am slightly paranoid about copyright shit kind of making this part... you know, being unable to be viewed by, like, anywhere, because that has been a bit of a growing concern for me, mainly in terms of the fact that... you know, the parts don't get as much exposure, and, well, considering the amount of movie material that's being used... yeah, these parts might be in for some editing around about the point where they get uploaded, but you know what, I figured I might as well talk over the scene since... really, not much is really being discussed here, like, I mean... and I guess if I could also highlight a little something in terms of what exactly, you know, Captain Locke and Niobe's relationship really is. I mean, they are together, but I mean, it does also touch upon the fact that Niobe was previously with Morpheus, only really leaving him because of the fact that he was kind of fanatically obsessed with the prophecy of the One. Which I mean, you know, is reasonable grounds to dump somebody. But I mean, I don't know, if you've seen The Matrix Revolutions, you know where this goes, but... I don't know. I mean, I guess it does kind of provide an interesting thing, since, you know, Locke is very... very anti-prophecy, and which is reasonable considering the fact that he is, you know, a military leader who does kind of have to focus on the here and now rather than... Well, I guess what to him is ostensibly singing Kumbaya and hoping for Super Jesus Keanu Reeves to save them? I don't know. I mean, it is very interesting, and I believe if you have the Persephone kiss scene with Niobe, it does also tend to highlight that a little bit better, and, well, I would have shown that, but there is also another scene that I think does highlight it a little bit better, which is between Niobe and the Oracle, so when we get to it, I'll let that scene play out, you know, as needed. The only thing I'm really worried about now is just wondering whether or not I'll have to do, like, the... whether I'm gonna have to put this through, like, a filter of... the raster setting, you know, where it looks incredibly shit and pixelated. Like in a Sega CD kind of way. I don't want to do that, but I mean, if push comes to shove, I might just have to. Because, I mean, unlike The Matrix Path of Neo, as I said before, I can't cut these out because these are originally filmed for the game, but I mean... If YouTube's algorithm picks it up as, hey, you're uploading The Matrix Reloaded to the cinema YouTube thing, we're gonna have to give you a copyright strike, because this is evil. I don't know. Finicky fucking systems. But I mean, nonetheless, a truly heartfelt moment between these two. Unfortunately, we get no awkward sex scene like we had in Reloaded, but whatever.
You call that concentration?
I didn't think you'd have the guts to come back here after the last ass-whipping I gave you.
That, dear brother, was an act of pure mercy, having beaten you now... how many times? Gosh, I guess I lost count when it hit double digits.
That, dear sister, was typical of the coddling members of my sex must bestow upon members of your sex to cajole them into playing.
Oh yeah, that's it. You've done it again. You'll eat those words and half the rocks in this garden.
Come on, Trent. Make me.
And so now we have our boss battle against Trinity. Yes, and unlike The Matrix Path of Neo, where she was very obviously voiced by Jennifer Hale doing her general Samus Aran Shina Fujibayashi Bastel Shan kind of voice, yeah, this is the real deal. This is Carrie Ann Moss voicing Trinity, which is... again, it's much better. Shame they couldn't get it back for The Path of Neo, but I mean, you know, she's an actress who has a career and shit, so... understandable. Again, this boss battle is really nothing to, you know, sweat about. It's basically just having a bit of a play with Trinity. Which is quite fine, despite the fact that Ghost is kind of a raging sexist. Well, I mean, not really. I'm pretty sure it is just playful banter, but, you know... you can kinda see where the scene is heading, because, well, I mean, if you're wondering where exactly, Ghost's feelings lie with Trinity, yeah, this was the unrequited love that Persephone brought up. He has a thing for Trinity, but because the prophecy of the One dictates that she would fall in love with Neo, yeah, that doesn't exactly work, so... well, Ghost is basically taken to the life of celibacy. And there is an upcoming line, which, well, I'll let you hear it, but... I wholeheartedly stand by, because that's possibly just me being a lonely fuck who, well, is lonely. Oh well. Celibacy is a hands-on experience. I don't know. Like, I mean, this is nowhere near as, you know, heart-pumping as the boss battle against Cujo or Vlad, so... really, just have fun with it, and enjoy Ghost falling on his ass. I don't know. That and I also do really like the setting, especially with the outfits. I think they fit the scene. You don't like them? I don't know. There's just something about the Japanese rock gardens, which, you know, having actually seen them in real life myself, they're beautiful, man. I always love the setting. And also, Trinity is making a very horrible mess of his garden. But then again, maybe Ghost will kinda like that.
Damn, you are good, Ghost.
You're not bad. Just a little distracted.
Yeah. I suppose so. Made a mess of your garden.
I kinda like it.
Ghost. Can I ask you a serious question?
Of course.
Do you believe that Neo is going to end the war?
Yes, I do.
So do I.
but I can't explain how or why.
Kierkegaard reminds us that belief is nothing to do with how or why. Belief is beyond reason. I believe because it is absurd.
You think it's crazy to believe it?
To believe what? That a single man can defeat an entire race of machines and end a war that has endured for over 100 years? Of course, it's complete lunacy, and that's why we must believe it will happen. Faith, by its very nature, must transcend logic.
When are we going to find you a girlfriend?
Like Augustine, I'm dedicated to a higher purpose.
What's that?
Onanism.
Is that why so many saints are blind?
Celibacy is a hands-on job.
Thank you, Ghost.
Anytime.
And back again, because this isn't a very lengthy movie cutscene again, which might also activate the algorithm. And also, by the way, another important thing to really note here is that this is the Oracle's second actress, because I believe... Well, not I believe. I mean, because in between filming of Reloaded and The Matrix Revolutions, the original actress actually died. Basically they kind of had to hastily write in, like, a little scene. I think it was meant to be actually between... Satya and her parents, where basically the Oracle gave up her original form, and that's explaining the actor change. I mean, you know, can't really be helped, but I mean, it's kind of unfortunate the circumstances of what happened, so... Yeah. I believe this is also something that's touched on in The Matrix Path of Neo, actually, where, I believe, you know, when you rescue Ballard from the restaurant, like, he says that he'll pass on the message to the Oracle, which, yeah, nice bit of continuity on the Wachowski's part. Also, this really does a decent job of humanizing Ballard in, like, a very brief few scenes, compared to what he gets in the movie. Like, I mean, especially with the line you'll see after he, you know, finishes his little fight with Seraph.
Good. You do not truly know someone until you fight them. Come with me.
Only thing you know about me is I was about to kick your ass.
That's the line. I don't know. That's just something so amusing about that to me. But, yeah. Also, trying to remember what I was, my train of thought. Yeah, a lot of this is really just sort of set up so that, you know, well, again, there, we find out what happens to Bane, and basically just sort of playing catch-up to where Niobe and Ghost were in Reloaded. Because, I mean, again, this is where the sort of cross-platform interaction between Enter the Matrix and Reloaded really comes into play. You know, so this is also explaining how Niobe and Ghost were there during the truck chase scene. Because at this point, Neo, Trinity, and Morpheus, well, I mean, a little bit after this point, obviously, yeah, they're being, you know, rescuing the Keymaker, who was kind of important, and crossed with Niobe and Ghost a little bit before he was supposed to. But, regardless of such. One thing I will say, though, that, I mean, damn, there was another thing I was going to talk about, but I kind of got distracted with the, Oracle's actor change kind of thing. I don't know, I suppose... I don't know. I guess one thing I could also talk about in the lull in between before I can finally remember anything is that it's mainly the interaction between Niobe, Ghost, and Sparks. Again, completely unrelated to what's on screen, but I mean, again, you've probably heard it throughout the game, you know, with Sparks being very snarky, Ghost being very, you know, sagely and philosophical, and Niobe being the tough-as-nails bitch who kicks ass and, you know, eats grenades and swallows them whole. Like, I mean, I don't know, I just love their dynamic. It really kind of balances out, you know, the Logos trio, which, you know, say what you will about, you know, Enter the Matrix being disappointing because it doesn't have Neo in it, you know, I think the characters that we do get to see and interact with regularly are pretty memorable, because, I don't know, there's just something about the Logos trio that just kind of appeals to me, especially Sparks. Like, I mean, he is kind of a bit of a borderline lazy, cowardly, snarky dick, but, I don't know, the way he seems to interact with Niobe and Ghost, especially with a couple of upcoming scenes, especially this one here, actually, like, where he, you know, I guess he sort of coerces Ghost into trying to convince Niobe not to do completely dangerous, suicidal shit. It's, I don't know. It's just something about their dynamic that I just absolutely love. Contact the NIB. Find out
find out what's happening.
I mean, granted, Niobe is there to, you know, kind of snap them into place and tell them to get to work because she is captain. But, I mean, I don't know, there is also a sort of relaxing element between all three of them. I mean, I guess Ghost brings in the more, you know, reflective sort of characterization, while Sparks brings in that sort of human element where he's not exactly wanting to get into the line of fire and just sort of, I don't know, wants to slack up and be lazy, I guess. Like all people who sit on the computer all day, doing stuff. And yeah, if you're wondering what's going to be happening right here, well, yeah, so you can tell by the opening chords of Mona Lisa Overdrive, we're going to be getting to one of the coolest parts of The Matrix Reloaded. Or at least for me anyway, because, like, I mean, the chase scene on the freeway was by far one of my favorite set pieces in the movie. Also, well, not exactly one-to-one to The Matrix movies, but close enough. And here we go, Mona Lisa Overdrive. I can't quite remember what the rest of the name of the track was. I don't know, the song that goes... I don't know. This is one of my favorite... I don't know, man, it's enjoyable. And, yeah, despite the fact that, you know, you are dealing with the game's shitty driving controls and have to constantly worry about police and agents being on your ass, well, it's a lot easier than the twins because the AI isn't anywhere near as persistent. And likewise, I mean, while it is just drive forward and avoid traffic, you know, it's a scene from the movie and you are there to chase down Morpheus and kind of provide the help that you see them, you know, in the end of The Matrix Reloaded itself, so... I don't know. For being able to play through a movie set piece, I think is good. And it's something that The Matrix Path of Neo didn't really cover. I guess maybe because Enter the Matrix kind of already covered it, but, like, I mean... I don't know. It would have been cool to have, like, maybe, like, a flying sequence where you go in and actually rescue Morpheus and the Keymaker. I don't know. It's just weird sort of thing about that. Anyway, this is the part where the police come in and, well, gotta use Ghost and blast him down. Again, it's a very, very basic sort of driving sequence, but one of the better handled ones in the game, I'd like to say. I guess mainly just down to the fact that it is really just a direct hallway, you don't really have to think too hard about anything. It's more or less just making sure that you can survive, although, that being said, one other thing I would also like to bring up, as I said last time, use the analog stick to accelerate. Because, I mean, you can use the X button, as I mentioned all the way back in part 2, I believe. But the problem is that because of the fact that the PS2 often had very pressure-sensitive controls when it came to, you know, driving, which is true for a lot of games of the era, like, you know, Jack 2, Grand Theft Auto 3, and all that sort of stuff. Yeah, it's nowhere near sensitive enough, so, I mean, if you tilt the analog stick to full speed, then you'll be going at full speed, which is kind of essential because you really do need that to catch up with the truck here. I mean, so long as you don't fall behind too far, it's nowhere near as bad as, say, the airplane scene with, Ghost in the Aqueducts, but likewise, it's not something that you want to dilly-dally with. Especially since, you know, long-term damage can kind of whittle down the car, because like before, the car doesn't have a separate health bar of its own, and you will basically need to survive until you catch up with the truck, which you can see as you see Morpheus and the agent he's fighting getting closer. So again, it is in your best interest to really, you know, gun it. And there's a helicopter just outside, please go the fuck away, I'm cutting a commentary, it's very distracting. But I mean, like I said, when you do use the forward analog stick, you can get some pretty decent distance. Like, I mean, coming across very few pieces of resistance here, so... yeah, kinda makes you wonder what the point of it all is. Well, I mean, except when Niobe tells them that they're back, so I guess maybe they reconvene pursuit? I don't know, strange. I do kind of wish they did liven up the roads a little bit more here, like, kind of having a few more advertisements with cooler looking stuff there, like instead of just having the generic watch TV kind of thing. I don't know. Like, I mean, maybe a couple of Powerade advertisements? I don't know. That could have been fun. Maybe have like a Powerade truck on the road or something? I don't know, just a little bit of visual things to kind of spice up the very long freeways, which according to Morpheus was suicide, which is actually true, because I really don't fucking like driving on freeways, man, they freak me the fuck out. Jesus Christ, especially during like fucking heavy traffic seasons, man, like it's part of the reason why I dread Christmas holidays when I have to see family, because well, driving is fucking scary. Well, I mean, both that and for congestion reasons, but I mean, that's another can of worms entirely. But I mean, you know, music's decent, cityscape is okay-ish, I guess. Actually, you know what, this is actually giving me major vibes of Sonic Adventure 2, really, like when you're chasing down the President or Tails. I don't know. I mean, I would like to... I don't think it would have been something the Wachowskis would have taken influence with, but I mean, then again, they were... I believe they were, like, video game fans as well, so, like, I mean, could have been possible. I mean, I seem to remember them having some sort of interaction with Hideo Kojima, which might have played a bit of part in his development of Metal Gear Solid 2. Maybe in the early phases, though, because, I mean, I seem to remember Kojima wanting to give Dead Cell sunglasses.
Oh, I can't watch this.
Yeah.
Can I have your personal processing unit?
I can't hear you.
I said, can I have your personal processing unit?
You might think that that was just Sparks talking random computer jargon, and something I didn't really figure out when I was a kid, but yeah, that's not Sparks, like, requesting their location as I initially thought. No, that's him asking for Ghost's computer, because he's a fucking scummy shit. I kind of find it curious as to how Sparks thinks he's gonna get back, since I sincerely doubt he's had any pilot training. So, yeah, good luck getting the logos back to Zion in one piece, you scummy fool. But I mean, snarkiness aside, that is, you know, another example of despite all the dangers, you know, you have playful bits of interaction. Like, I mean, it's not fourth wall breaking comedy, but, you know, just playful interactions between characters despite, you know, having a very serious scene. I don't know. I talked about this beforehand, but I'm like, I mean, it's very easy to break the tone in many cases, but I don't know, the way The Matrix really handled its jokes for what few that it has, you know, it felt natural. And that, above anything else, is really what you need in terms of comedic timing. But yeah, before too long, the truck will be in sight, and well, we'll basically be catching up to Morpheus, and good lord, my eyes are starting to sweat. Jesus, what the hell's going on with my vision? It's kind of blurring a little bit. I think maybe when I'm done here, I'll probably just grab a bite to eat and go outside for a little bit. My eyes are getting hazy. That being said, though, I do think the police presence has kind of increased here because, well, for obvious reasons, there's a runaway truck going completely apeshit. But, yeah, kind of defeats many interesting things to really talk about at this stage. I suppose at this point, depending on your sources, Neo is just running through the chateau or distorted dimensions, so who knows where he is, really. Perhaps, I think at this point, he might be battling the witch with the rogue program he's teamed up with. The Key, I believe her name was. Yeah, that's right, because I'm a dumbass, I'm remembering all this shit. I don't know. Like, I mean, I will kind of call Path of Neo's, like, canonicity into question with certain things, but I mean, in my personal headcanon, I count, like, some of the additional sequences, like the, like, you know, the subway scene and the, bloody, fuck, what was it? Distorted dimension scene as canon, because fuck it, I like it, and, well, nobody's gonna tell me otherwise, damn it. And you can very faintly see the truck inside. Just gonna destroy a couple more police cars. I don't know. I guess if there was anything else I could really say, I do kind of wish they could have livened up things a little bit more here. But I mean, I guess the novelty of... I guess maybe it's more of an interesting thing to play than to watch because... Well, I mean, you do have the novelty of this being an interactive set piece from the movie, so... I guess it kind of fulfills people's wishes in that way? I don't really know what to say. I guess really, it's more fun than it is more fun to play than it is to watch. But anyway, we're nearing the end of this, so on that note, I'm Solidus-Skully, keep it new metal, and I can't quite sign off yet because this is a direct scene lifted from the movie, and as you can tell by the very Matrix green tint, yeah, this is directly lifted. So this one, I think, might definitely have to be edited if I get any grief from it. But we do get to see Morpheus's cool flying kick, so kick. And he crashes into that lovely family of cars, which are, you know, I'm sure is very lovely. And we also get our one sole appearance of Neo in this game. Well, regardless of whether or not you count the extras mode, like the little secret fighting game tournament thing that you can unlock in the hacking mode. So anyway, as we see this really fucking cool looking explosion, on that note, I am Solidus-Skully, keep it new metal, and next time on the Enter the Matrix commentary, well, see you next time. Hi, Neo. Okay then. Bye-bye.